Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. As long as there are empires to be conquered, the British were always there. The last place that they had not really investigated or conquered was the South Pole. This is the story of the men who tried and succeeded after a fashion, but they weren't the first. The book is called An Empire of Ice, Scott Shackleton and the Heroic Age of Antarctic Science. It's written by my guest, Edward J. Larson. It's published by Yale University Press. Welcome, Ed.
Great to be here again. Thank you.
Thank you, because this book is incredible. I mean, it's incredible, beginning with the fact that a man named Amundsen from Norway was the first to go there. He dressed like an Inuit Eskimo, so he had fur on him. He had dogs that were pulling his sled, and he was the first to get to the South Pole, and I guess it's 90 degrees is the word.
Yes, 90 degrees south.
And he gets it, he builds a tent, he puts the Norwegian flag up, and he leaves a letter for the two men who may follow him: tell your king, in essence, I was here first.
That's what he did. The British had been working hard to get there intensively for 10 years, and in a broader fashion for 100 years. And Norway was then a new country. He literally stole the march. Scott was already in the field. He knew Scott was going. He didn't even tell anybody he was going. He told people he was going to the North Pole, but instead actually sailed south and surprised Scott.
Yeah. So on this page is Robert Scott and Ernst Shackleton, the two men who both would try and would compete. Now, the Royal, two societies were?
The Royal Society and the Royal Geographic Society both provided the support to enable Scott to go the first time. Scott didn't make it. Shackleton went back, and then, of course, finally Scott went back on the one that was turned out to be in a race with Amundsen. He didn't know it would be a race when he started, but it turned out to be a race.
Well, the other part is Amundsen had the dogs who pulled his sled. The English were being very British and saying, our men will pull our sledges. Right. What were they like?
Oh, the things they were pulling, they would typically, when loaded, could weigh 3/4 of a ton. And they were pulled by the men. Sometimes two were tagged on to each other. That might work okay if the ice is fairly smooth, but that's not what you're going to get most of the time. Often the ice would be almost like sand. And if you can imagine pulling a half-ton sledge in 50, 60, 70 below zero Fahrenheit, across sand. Imagine going down the beach in Santa Monica, pulling this heavy sled, which would often sink so low that the crossbars would be plowing through the snow. And you're right, the men had to do it. Where Amundsen, he had dogs pulling the sleds, and they were on skis. And of course, the Norwegians, especially Amundsen, were expert skiers.
Not only that, but the men, when finally Scott, I believe, started with dogs, he had the men working with the dogs, and the dogs did not like having a man as its companion.
No, it's something that he should have known. Of course, Amundsen knew it because he had trained up in the northern Canada. He'd been the first one to go around the Northwest Passage, and he learned it. But Scott didn't quite know that men and dogs cannot pull together. If there's a man pulling, the dog will just rest. They won't pull. If they're just pulling and the men are on skis or the men are behind them trying to mush them on, then it works. That's what the Norwegians were doing. No, Scott, the first trip, he was all man hauling. And then when Shackleton went back, he took ponies because he thought ponies would work better. They didn't. But they worked better than untrained dogs.
At least became food for them later when they were starving.
They became food for the British. The British would not eat dogs. The Norwegians were willing to. But the British weren't, but they were willing to eat horses. And so they would take the horses, and then they'd have a ready food supply. But I guess the British are used to have dogs being pets. Yeah. And so They didn't want the dogs to suffer, and so they did use dogs for transporting around, but what they basically tried to use dogs in the final one, dogs, ponies, and even tractors to try to place depots. But no, the heavy work of going across the polar plateau, that was man hauling all the way.
Oh, but I love the story of somebody who had donated money to Shackleton, and he got an automobile that was then put, what, on skis?
There was quite a bit of promotional activity. Many sponsors donated things.
Yeah.
They were proper British, so they always had afternoon tea. Lipton provided the tea, and they had to advertise, and they had ads back in England saying Lipton tea, and there's lots of pictures of them down there drinking Lipton tea that they were going to use for advertising. But in a similar way, the Pierce Arrow Auto Company donated a car and some money, and in return, Shackleton, for his expedition, had to take one of these cars down and replace the front wheels with skis and put sort of treads on the back wheels, and the idea that was going to be the first car and they were going to use it to maneuver around the sea ice. It didn't work very well, though I've seen the garage. When I was down there, they still have the garage where it was housed.
You did go down there on your own trip.
The National Science Foundation, I'm pleased to say, sent me down, so I appreciate the American taxpayers paying for that, and I was able to get to all the sites where the earlier explorers did their research, did their science, and did their exploring. So I was able to go to the dry valleys, to the various different huts, which are still there, by the way. The huts, because it's well below zero all the time, the huts are sort of frozen in place, and these were the huts that were built. They're actually larger than you'd think, cottage more than a hut. Where Scott Shackleton, there are three of them, and then I was able to go into the South Pole, climb Mount Erebus, do the various things these scientists and researchers and explorers did, because if I wanted to write about it, to really understand it, I had to experience it, and it enabled me to appreciate much more what they saw and what they did. Of course, I had a team of people from National Science Foundation backing me up, and I got to go with scientists.
What were they looking for at this moment?
Back in the earlier time, when Scott and Shackleton first went down, amazingly, they didn't even know if there was a continent in the South Pole.
Yeah.
They knew there were some islands, but they thought it could be like the North Pole, where there's islands like Baffin Island, and then it's a polar ice cap.
Mm-hmm.
And so when Scott went down the first time in 1901, he thought he'd just sail across the frozen ice cap and get easily to the pole. It didn't work out that way, because what they discovered was there's a continent there. There was a whole range of mountains, what we now call the Transarctic Mountains, that split it, and you have to go up those mountains to 9,000 feet and then go across the polar plateau to get where the pole is. So they were trying to find out if it's a continent, or if it was a group of islands. They were trying to. They knew there were. They wanted to study the animals there, which they had never at that time. No one had ever really studied at all the emperor penguins. Yeah. They had barely seen any, and they discovered their breeding habits, that they bred in the middle of winter.
Yeah, and where did they stop? At Ross Sea.
The Ross Sea had been discovered earlier. There's Ross Island, and they would stay on Ross Island, and then they would go across onto the mainland. And they did, of course, study geology. They studied glaciology. They studied meteorology. They studied oceanography. Basically, what they discovered for the first time is that the world is a single ecosystem, and that the South Pole, that huge cold mass, governs the ocean currents and also the world's air currents. And they, in their research, when studying the glaciers and their retreat, they discovered global warming.
Yeah, because here we're worried today. Back there, over 100 years ago, the ice was retreating.
Retreating significantly, which was news to everyone. And so they studied it, where it had been, what had been happening to it. But so basically, they discovered that this is what we would call modern ecology, and that the world's environmental system is governed by this ice box down at the South Pole, and how important that ice box is to all of us.
And now we get to the fact that there were characters, because Shackleton took great offense that Scott had written about him as being failing in health, as if he were an invalid, and as a put-down. And Shackleton was not going to tolerate that.
Then the first expedition with Scott, when Shackleton went along, Scott was supposed to be in charge, and he didn't suffer any insolence. He ran the expedition as a naval expedition. With he and the officers, they ate at separate tables. They had proper tea. They had a certain status. Now, Ernest Shackleton had been pushed onto the expedition. He wanted to go, but he wasn't Royal Navy. And he, even though he was lieutenant on the expedition, sort of fourth in command, he had his own mind. And the result was there was a constant tension. And so Scott sent him back after their first polar effort. And from then on, because just as you described it, he'd sort of said, oh, Shackleton's not up to this. Shackleton was going to prove he was up to it and went down again. And there was an ongoing rivalry between the two men they're both very strong characters. Even Antarctica, even the continent, was not big enough place for the two of them.
There's an interesting man at the bottom of this page, Markham. His role in the expedition?
Well, Clements Markham was crucial to it happening. Yeah. He had been on earlier Arctic explorations when they were looking, what was called the Franklin Search, looking for the Franklin who had been lost in the trying to find the Northwest Passage. And he had loved the camaraderie of the Navy.
Yeah.
He didn't like the work, and he was aristocrat. He had plenty of money, and he dropped out of the Navy, but became one of the leaders of the Royal Geographic Society. Yeah. And he always was pushing for naval expeditions to do exploring. He did a lot of exploring himself. In Peru and in India and other places. And so he helped launch an attempt to go to the North Pole, and then when that failed, he set his sights on sending an expedition to the South Pole. So he was the sort of a one-man cheerleading squad. He led the Royal Geographic Society into it. He led the Royal Society into it. He got support from the government. But he always wanted it done his way, and he was the one who thought that Brits should not use dogs, they should manhaul. He had this Victorian sort of visionary notion. He was a very strange man. There were a lot of stories about his activities, but he was a determined and dogged person.
This is also a period in England's history, as you point out in the book, after the British had felt they couldn't fail at anything. And then suddenly in South Africa, the Boer War.
The Boer War was very shaping to British psyche because they were almost beaten by these Dutch settlers, and they had to send down tremendous numbers of soldiers. That many of the people who went on the expedition had fought in the Boer War, had been connected with it, including Ernest Shackleton. Now. Who was part of the Merchant Marine at that time, ferrying troops. But first they had that. And then on top of that, Germany is beginning to build. They had unified into a single country. They had become the most powerful continental power. And that was a threat to the British psyche. So they wanted to prove themselves. Of course, all of this is happening in the shadow of World War I. People knew it was coming. People knew something was coming. There was this recent television show on PBS, Downington Abbey. It captures the sort of upstairs, downstairs lifestyle and the sense of that, yes, we're the most powerful empire in the history of the world. Yes, we rule a quarter of the entire